بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين، وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، وبعد. فقد قال جل وعلا في كتابه المجيد وفرقانه الحميد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وقالوا: لولا نزل هذا القرآن على رجل من القريتين عظيم. أهم يقسمون رحمة ربك؟ نحن قسمنا بينهم معيشتهم في الحياة الدنيا، ورفعنا بعضهم فوق بعض درجات ليتخذ بعضهم بعضا سخريا، ورحمة ربك خير مما يجمعون. وقال النبي صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم: بعثت لأتمم مكارم الأخلاق، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. Honorable scholars, respected brothers, elders, mothers and sisters, as humans, as mortals, by our very instinct and our temperament, we are prone to err. Whether it is the decisions we make or the choices we exercise, sometimes we regret the car we bought or the home we sold, and many, without generalizing, have second thoughts on the partners they wed. But like they say in English, the problem with children is, and the same applies to partners, they're not returnable. Children are not returnable. Partners are not returnable. So this man got married, he wasn't all that impressed. He wrote a letter to his mother-in-law: product doesn't satisfy the requirement. So she replied, she was an intellectual mother-in-law, she said, seal broken, warranty void. You've deflowered her, and now you want to drop her and dump her. My point is, in essence, fallibility is part of our nature. We are fallible creatures. We will err, we will slip, we will regret. Our decisions are flawed, are blemished. This is common, this is human, this is in our instinct. The flip side of the coin is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is flawless, He is blemishless, He is impeccable, and He is infallible. When we chose Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as the paragon of this creation, there possibly could be no second opinion to this decision. Everything of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pure and pristine. Not only were the humans, even the angels, even the jinnat, everyone saluted, honored and revered this decision of Allah, to the extent that the Arabic poet said, شهد الأنام بفضله حتى العدا والفضل ما شهدت به الأعداء. Then leave the Muslim world, even the foe and the enemy and those who were hostile to Islam had to concede that we dislike Muhammad, but he is the greatest human sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then the Arabic poet goes on to say, والفضل ما شهدت به الأعداء. The excellency of an individual is that to which his enemy can testify and not his friends. The excellency of an individual is that to which his enemy can testify. Now to focus, just to focus, our topic of discussion today is solace in the prophetic teachings amidst global unrest. I don't have to elaborate to you. Perhaps if somebody could just attend to the brothers as they are streaming in. MashaAllah, we have an overflowing audience. May Allah reward you. If somebody could just usher them in and settle them down so that we could maintain momentum in the talk. The focus of the topic is that how do we find guidance, solace in the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this hostile climate around us. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was selected and nominated and crowned with prophethood, The ayat al-kareema that I recited, some disbelievers objected to this. And they said,
وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ عَلَىٰ رَجُلٍ مِّنَ الْقَرْيَتَيْنِ عَظِيمٍ.
Why was not the Quran revealed on a more prominent personality between Mecca and Taif? And their inference and their reference was to either Walid ibn Mughira or Urwa ibn Mas'ud, who lived in Taif. They said these are more prominent, high profile, intellectually stimulating humans. They were more deserving candidates for prophethood. This was their objection. Allah has given many answers. The immediate response of the Quran was, أَهُمْ يَقْسِمُونَ رَحْمَةَ رَبِّكَ أَهُمْ يَقْسِمُونَ رَحْمَةَ رَبِّكَ نَحْنُ قَسَمْنَا بَيْنَهُمْ مَعِيشَتَهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. We haven't allowed the humankind to decide their own sustenance. How will we allow them to decide who becomes a prophet? No human has the ability to decree and define his own sustenance. فَلَوْ أَنَّ الْعُقُولَ تَسُوقُ رِزْقًا لَكَانَ الْمَالُ عِنْدَ ذَوِ الْعُقُولِ. If it was sheer intellect that secured wealth, then the intellectual would be wealthy. But I have seen people who perhaps don't know how to sign, yet they own empires. This is the reality, and it is Allah who decides the sustenance of every person. Be it as it may, the point I'm saying is, when Allah chose Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah groomed, fashioned his life to perfection. And it is only in his prophetic formula will you and I and the world in its entirety, with the global unrest that is unfolding on the political landscape of the world, and many things are happening, we have to turn to the noble life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to find direction, guidance and navigation. Now what I want to do today is, I want to extract certain angles from his blessed life. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as a human to fellow non-Muslims. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as a partner to his honorable consorts. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as a father to his children. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as a senior to juniors. So thereby, try and internalize this into our lives. The first point of reflection from his blessed life sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was when he migrated from Mecca to Medina, and in the interim they had gone to perform the Umrah and they were denied entry into Mecca. Subsequently the peace treaty was signed, and you need to know, and let me refresh your memory, that when this peace treaty was signed, it was a very one-sided thing. It was leaning in favor of the disbelievers and it was against the Muslims. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam agreed to the very bitter clauses, to the very, very bitter clauses, to the extent the hadith is in Bukhari Sharif, the climate was so hostile against the Muslims, that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them, let's sign this pact and this agreement, and he said, right, this is an agreement between Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the people of Makkah, they said, this is at the heart of our contention. We don't accept you as the Prophet of Allah. If we accepted you, we would have allowed you in Makkah. You will rephrase this pact and agreement by saying, this is an agreement between Muhammad, the son of Abdullah, simply because we don't recognize your prophethood. Sahaba were in rage and fury. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I am the Prophet of Allah, even if you choose to deny it. They said, we won't go ahead till you don't delete and erase. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told the Sahaba, delete. Sahaba took a back step. They said, oh Nabi of Allah, this is literally pushing the boundaries too far. This is now pushing the boundaries just too far. I don't think we're bound to bow backwards. We've given to every request of theirs. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, show it to me where it's written, because he was unlettered, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then deleted it. The agreement continued, and the beauty part of this here is, I don't want to digress into the details of this, immediately thereafter Surah Fatah was revealed. And in Surah Fatah, Allah made reference to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as Muhammadur Rasulullah,
والذين معه أشداء على الكفار رحماء بينهم.
محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم is the prophet of Allah. The scholars of tafsir unpack this and they say in this verse Allah made detailed reference. Allah didn't say Muhammad وما محمد إلا رسول ومبشرا برسول يأتي من بعد اسمه أحمد. One place Allah said Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, أحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. But here Allah gave a detailed explanation and Allah said Muhammadur Rasulullah. And what is the wisdom and what is the tie and what is the explanation that you chose to deny this name in your pact? Immediately we gave a detailed recognition in the Quran. So neither your pact remain nor you remain, but Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's name remained in the Quran. One of the agreements were, one of the clauses were, that if a Muslim migrates or if a Muslim moves from Medina to Mecca, then he will be withheld and apprehended and he will not be returned to Medina. But if a non-Muslim leaves from Mecca and he comes to Medina, then he will come so, do so freely, he will not be harassed, he will not be intimidated, he will not be apprehended, he will be given a free passage into Medina, do his work and return back to Mecca without any form of harassment. This particular deal was in process when a Sahabi by the name of Abu Jundul was shackled and he was kneeled and he came before the Sahaba. His condition was rather appalling. He was bruised, he was hurt, he was injured, there was blood oozing from his body. Sahaba were on an emotional note. They barely had to contend with the hostility of the denial of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's name. Then they had to digest this difficult clause and it coincides with a Sahabi who was shackled before them. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, okay, in principle I agree to this clause. If any Muslim migrates from Mecca to Medina, then we will return him. We will return him. But here is a man, we haven't yet gone back. Can we make an exception to the clause in his favor only? They said, oh Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you open the topic again, we'll scrap the whole agreement. Sahaba's rage and fury, panic and emotion knew no bounds. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked at him and he said, I've tried my level best. I've exhausted communication, but really they display great hostility. Persevere and return. It's a painful sight and it hurts my emotions. May Allah be with you. Can you imagine? Sahaba were not seeing footage. They were not seeing, they were seeing live the man in front of him. This was how aggressive the hostility was. But what was the formula of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? On a subtle note, this made inroads for the disbelievers from Mecca to come to Medina with great ease and comfort. And what happened? They came as businessmen, they looked at the climate of Medina, they studied the lives of Medina, they seen the atmosphere of Medina, they were impressed by the ambience of Medina, they came as tradesmen and they returned as Sahaba. History bears testimony to the fact that in the blessed 23 years of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no period, no campaign, no expedition brought such an influx into Islam as Hudaybiyah did. Each campaign and expedition had its plus and its good. But Hudaybiyah suddenly, then they knew that the Muslims are governed by a peace treaty and they cannot harass us. So they were coming to Medina and said, but just look at how beautiful these people's lives are. Just look at how wholesome their character is. Just look at how awesome their dealings are. It is so brilliant, so wonderful. And these were the type of things. One incident of one Sahabi and then we'll move on to the point. Jarir ibn Abdullah Bajali radiallahu anhu, this is mentioned by Imam Nawawi, the great Shafi'i scholar who has done the commentary on Muslim Sharif. Jarir ibn Abdullah Bajali radiallahu anhu had vowed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam an amazing vow. The Sahaba used to come and make different vows. His vow was, I will be kind, faithful and loyal to every Muslim in all my affairs and all my dealings. So one day he goes to purchase a horse from a person. بَيَعْتُ النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَلَى النُّسْحِ لِكُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ. He goes to the person, he says, brother, are you selling this horse? He says, yes, what's the price? 400 dirhams. He tells the person, you're undercharging me, charge me more. He said, hello? Imagine, have you ever heard of this type of interaction? But these were the students who